It's the 17th of April, 1970, and I've been trapped in space, fighting to stay alive for 4 days now, and I'm yet to face the biggest challenge, my re-entry into Earth. I am James Lovell, commander of Apollo 13. I am the most experienced astronaut on this spacecraft, possibly even the world, and I'm the commander of this craft. Before I became an astronaut, I was a U.S. Naval test pilot, where I was selected for the astronaut program. This Apollo mission was meant to land us in the Fra Mauro region of the moon, an area that has not yet been explored. I was on the Apollo 8 mission, which orbited the moon for the first time in history, but I was particularly excited to land on the moon. But it would seem that this dream would not come true, as the mission was abandoned some 4 days ago. Many back on Earth have grown disinterested in people landing on the moon, since it has happened twice already. I'm hoping this journey of disaster, teamwork, and, if all goes well, survival, will again captivate the public's hearts and minds. Our mission started smoothly. We had liftoff on April 11th, 1970. Many people had called our mission cursed or unlucky, as it bore the number 13. But I was never much for superstition anyway. However, just 5 minutes into the flight, I felt vibrations, and so did the crew. The center engine had cut out 2 minutes early, which meant that the other two engines had to burn for longer than planned to set us on the correct path for the moon. I didn't worry too much about this, as something always crops up on a space mission, and this problem was not considered life-threatening. After 2 days, we were around 200,000 miles from the Earth when we received a communication from Mission Control. They asked us to flick the switch that would agitate the oxygen tanks to stop any buildup of dangerous gases. The moment the switch was flipped, we heard an explosion and felt a ripple of vibrations.
Houston, we've had a problem here.
I am Jack Swigert, and I am the command module pilot for Apollo 13. You know, this is my first spaceflight. I was a U.S. Air Force pilot and commercial test pilot before I became an astronaut, but I wasn't even meant to be on this spacecraft. I was substituted for Ken Mattingly shortly before April 11th, as Mattingly was believed to have been exposed to German measles. Little did I know that my first flight into space would become a survival mission. After the explosion, various warning lights flashed onto my screens. It was very quickly apparent that two of our three fuel cells were lost to the explosion. But what I found most worrying was that one of our oxygen tanks appeared to be completely empty, and the other one was losing oxygen. I knew that if we lost all our oxygen, the last fuel cell would die, and there would be no hope left for us. After an hour of trying to figure out the extent of the damage, we came to the agreement that we would need to use the Lunar Module as our lifeboat. We need the Command Module to return to Earth, as this is the only part of the spacecraft that had a protective heat shield and could re-enter the Earth's atmosphere. But it only had 15 minutes of power left, so we decided to power it down until we reached Earth. The normal supply of electricity, oxygen, and water to the module had been lost. As the command module piloted, it was my job to stay in the command module and finish the final tasks before going with the rest of the crew into the lunar module. This was a very stressful situation with a lot of pressure, so I decided to write the word no on a tiny piece of card and folded it over a switch that I most certainly did not want to accidentally use. This switch would have separated the lunar module from the rest of the spacecraft and would have spelled immediate disaster for all of us. My main concern was the fact that the lunar module was designed to support two men for 2 days. Instead, there were three of us, and we needed to survive for 4 days. Looking back now on our last days of survival, we were lucky. Apollo 11 showed us that the lunar module could survive for up to 7 or 8 hours in space without being water-cooled. This revelation allowed us to conserve some water, which kept us alive. Even with this extra water that we could consume, I was only allowed to consume 1/5 of my normal daily water intake. I'm sure I've lost a lot of weight, and I feel very dehydrated.
I am Fred Haise, and I am the lunar module pilot on board Apollo 13. This is my first expedition to space, and I was particularly looking forward to landing on the moon. As a U.S. Marine Corps fighter pilot and test pilot for the U.S. Air Force, I was used to working under pressure, but nothing could prepare me for what I was going to experience on board Apollo 13. After just a couple days in the lunar module, I saw warning lights that signaled dangerously high levels of CO2. Now, to start with, CO2 can affect your memory and ability to complete tasks at your usual speed. But when CO2 starts to reach dangerous levels, it poisons humans and will eventually starve your brain and vital organs of oxygen. I knew the lunar module was not designed to do what we were asking it to, and the CO2 chemical filters used to extract CO2 were fully saturated within 2 days. The problem we faced was the fact that the filters in the lunar module were round, but the other filters we had on the spacecraft were square. So we had to find a solution that literally fit a square plug into a round hole. With Mission Control's help, we devised a makeshift filter using duct tape, card, a plastic bag, and tube. The filter worked surprisingly well and cleaned the CO2 from our air. We had an estimated 2 days left until we reached Earth, and we had to ensure that we were on the proper course for a free return trajectory. That's a maneuver that uses gravity rather than propulsion to swing you in the right direction you want to go. I had to use all my skills as a pilot to help the crew navigate our way onto the right course for Earth. We had to use the sun as our navigational star and carefully maneuver using the little fuel we had left, all the time knowing that if we made a single small mistake, that it could lead to our deaths. For 4 days, the temperature has been getting colder, as our only source of heat, the equipment, was all powered down. The temperature is now 38 degrees Fahrenheit, and condensation is forming on the walls. We are about to shed Aquarius, the service module where the explosion occurred. We will then begin our descent into Earth's atmosphere. We are hoping that the heat shield has not been damaged by the explosion, otherwise we may burn upon re-entry. But our biggest concern is this condensation. Apollo 1 suffered from a disastrous fire in January 1967, but because of this incident, safeguards have been built into the design of the spacecraft. We are hoping that these safeguards will prevent short-circuiting and arching from happening within the spacecraft, which would be a disastrous end to our survival mission upon Apollo 13.
I am Lovell.
I am Swigert.
And I am Haise. And we are trapped in space on board Apollo 13. We are yet to face our biggest challenge. We have survived 4 days trapped in space after our spacecraft had an explosion. Against all odds, we have survived and we are about to re-enter the Earth's atmosphere.